There are two reasons I brought Don up here with me to the pulpit. He's aware of one of them. In a moment, he's going to become aware of the second. What's the first Chuck. Reason, Don? You've got
well,
our attention.
What I want to say is, tonight's going to be a very special night in this very auditorium. A chamber group from the Dallas Symphony Orchestra will be here. String quartet, brass quintet. Glorious music played well. This concert is free of charge. Parking is free, so there's every reason to come. It'll be tonight at 6 o'clock.
Parking.
Amen. All right. No.
Come back, Don.
Okay.
You've been holding out on me all these years. John, get at it.
I'll get you back for that.
This is no time to be reluctant, Don. Your mother went through a lot to bring you into this world. So, I'm going to ask you the ultimate question.
Okay.
But where were you born?
Florence Nightingale Hospital. That's Baylor Hospital, right down there on Gaston Avenue.
Really? Right here in Dallas?
Yes. I'm a native Dallasite.
Yeah.
I'm proud of it.
Now, are you the only child, or do you have a brother or sister?
I have one sister. Her name is Sherry, and she's 3 years older than I am.
Sherry's 3 years older.
Uh-huh. She lives over in Florida.
She's in Florida?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is there any confession you'd like to make today in front of this congregation? We're in an awfully good mood. We'll forgive you of anything.
Yeah. You know, a quid pro quo, Chuck, would be to remind the audience that your birthday was October 18.
Oh, quit. Yeah, right. When you... Don.
Yeah, I hit it, John.
Time to sit down, Don. Boy. After all these years, Don, you never told me. I want to find out whatever else you've never told me after the service today, so be thinking about that. We're sure glad all of you are here for Don's birthday. Thank you for coming. And especially our guests today, especially welcome you who are here for the first time, you who are online. Wonderful to have you as well. We have a wonderful gathering today from all around the world, as well as right here in the city of Frisco. I've not done this for a while, so I want you to stand up and say hello to somebody you've not met before. Okay, stand up nice and tall. Greet one another. Thank you. You may be seated. This is the closest we come to an altar call when we have these families come with their children to be dedicated. You may be a grandparent for one of these dear children up here, or maybe a godparent. If you are, just stand up. You don't have to do cartwheels. Just stand up, and we welcome you today. Wonderful day. This has biblical roots, what we are doing. Centuries ago, a woman named Hannah and her husband Elkanah were without children, and she prayed that the Lord would give her a child. She said, if you will do that, I will dedicate him to you. She meant that as an irrevocable dedication. She literally brought her son, whom the Lord did give her, to the Lord. She brought him to the tabernacle, and there he was raised by Eli the priest. I'm happy to say these parents are not going to leave their children with me today. They're going to take their children with them, but before they do, this is a moment for them to remember and for you as a church family to remember. If you parents will turn and face me, I have a few questions that you may answer in the simplest way, as you did when you got married, the words, I do. Here we go. First, do you testify today that you have come to know Christ as your own personal Savior? Do you desire that your home be a place where Christ is honored, where His word is read and obeyed?
I do.
Do you therefore dedicate your child to the Lord today, irrevocably giving him or her to the Lord, anticipating by faith that he or she will someday come to know Christ as you have?
I do.
Here's the tough one. Do you promise before God that you will give of your time, attention, energy, devotion, and prayer to instill within your little one an appetite for spiritual things, regardless of the sacrifice it may entail? Good for you. Good. Please stand. Let's stand as these parents have dedicated their children to the Lord, and let's pray. Our Father, we give each one of these children to you to do with as you please for your greater glory. These parents will need wisdom in this decadent era in which we live. Give them strength of character as well as courage. Help them to rear their children your way for your glory. May they build great character in the lives of their daughters and sons so that they will become citizens that honor you as their God and your Son as their Savior. We dedicate each child to you. Use each one for your glory and help these parents in the process to carry out these tasks in the energy of the Spirit of God. We pray this in the name of Christ, our Savior. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Dave Carl, who leads our children's ministry, will read the names for these children, and they will receive certificates from Heather today as they leave.
Brandon and Sarah Zates with their son, Austin Wade. Mark and Kaihuen Smith with their daughter, Angela Hope. Tyler and Kara Shade with their daughter, Autumn Reese. Nathan and Cassie Greider with their son, Reed Davis. Joshua and Vanessa Gomez with their son, Micah Elijah. Nathan and Nikki Blackter with their son, Ethan Duane. Neam and Christian Bitar with daughter, Emily Hope. I'm going to take a big breath on this one. Aaron and Shannon Benson with daughter, Aisha. Nala, Mia, Aaron, and Layla.
Oh.
And they got them all dressed and everything. So.
Good. It's a great time for us to thank Dave and Heather for their work with our children. Thank you so much.
Our musical worship this morning is going to center on a wonderful theme, and the theme is God has promised that He will lead us and guide us throughout our lives. We don't have to depend on our own understanding, our own knowledge, our own intuition, trying to be clever as we go through life, but if we will look to Him and seek His face, He will lead us and He will guide us. There's a psalm in our Bible that speaks to that theme very eloquently. It's Psalm 23. I remember it was the first Old Testament passage that I ever memorized as a child, and it's written by King David. Of course, it's a song, but it's also a poem. It's also a prayer, and you know the first line. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Well, David was very intimate with the relationship between shepherd and sheep because the first many years of his life, he was a shepherd. So he wrote part of this song about being a shepherd. Halfway through the song, though, the allegory changes, and the metaphor is now of God is a king who puts together banquets and invites people to banquets. Well, David had intimate knowledge of that as well because he was a king, and probably there are many times there was a big banquet table and some of his enemies were sitting there, and that's why he refers to that in the psalm. So as we study this together this morning, think about God is our shepherd, and He is also a king that invites us to the banquet table. Now, instead of speaking Psalm 23 aloud, I want you to see the words on the screen and just meditate on the message. We'll hold each screen up for about 10, 12 seconds, give you long enough to read it, maybe read it twice. Let's do that, and then we'll stand and sing.
Normally at this time, I would have you open your Bible to a particular passage of Scripture, but I'll not do that this morning. I would ask you to take the Bible that's in your lap and turn to Acts 4 and read the first 13 verses sometime between now and at the end of our time of the offering this morning. You may have your Bible in your phone or a copy of the scriptures, but we'll not read it now. I want to talk with you for a few moments. Last Sunday, we reached a milestone in our church's history as we celebrated 25 years of God's favor and blessing upon us. We looked somewhat in depth at Acts chapter 2 as the early church got started, like we got started, with nothing. Literally nothing, except God's presence and God's favor. The Lord gave them rapid growth, as he has done us. It went from 3,000 up to 5,000 men, and if we counted women and children, probably more like 10,000 back in the first century. But it was a world of opposition. It was a climate of prejudice and hatred, especially against the Christ whom the early church honored and preached and loved. So when you work your way through the book of Acts, you come to places where God shows himself strong as he gives those people in that first century extra strength, extra courage, invincible, unintimidated confidence to stand against the opposition that came against them. It occurred to me that what we have before us in this great book is a random set of occasions where God shows himself strong. So I want to do a series on that. I've never done that before. We sort of pick and choose our way through the book of Acts, stopping off at places where we see remarkable things accomplished, but perhaps God is in the shadows, behind the scenes, may not be that evident, or at least not that visible to those around him, but he is at work. As Francis Schaeffer once put it, he is there and he is not silent. Today we're looking at one of those scenes in the fourth chapter. Next time we'll look at another and yet another the following Sunday, and on we'll go through a number of these scenes in the book of Acts. Why would I do this? Because I know that many of you are going through difficult times, searching times. You may be in one of the most extreme situations you've ever found yourself. You may be going through a time of grief or loss, a time when you feel threatened. You may have recently lost your job or lost hope, or encountered a situation you never saw coming. Maybe a friend has turned on you. Perhaps a group of people in which you once found great delight now chooses not to include you. You feel a little like an outlier, an outcast, whatever. God is showing himself strong and will do so for you. All that you need to do is acknowledge it, to realize it. I will do that for us today from this story where Peter and John encounter a beggar at the temple gate and tell him, silver and gold, we have none, but and the power of Christ rise up and walk. And he did. The problem was they did that at the temple. The temple was run by religious thugs who were responsible for the crucifixion of Jesus. They hated the name of Christ. They were prejudiced against all things Christian. How dare these people speak of the one we put to death? We've gotten rid of him, hardly. And Peter and John are there as a reminder that God is at work and he isn't finished. I hope through this series you will be aware that God is involved in your situation, painful though it is. No suffering is easy, but it's necessary for us to reach maturity. I want to pray for us as a people. We're living in very difficult times, especially our Jewish friends in Israel, attacked by terrorists. Hundreds of their people have been murdered. Women, children, babies, grandparents. It's a desperate time. But God is at work. He has his way in the whirlwind and the storms, and the clouds are but the dust of his feet. Somehow, through it all, God will have his way. It will be for our good and for his glory. Stand with me, will you, for prayer before the offering this morning. How we need you, our Father. Every day we need you. Every hour we need you. We need you in the rearing of our children and our grandchildren. We need you when we're not sure what to do next. We need you when there is no guide, there's nothing written, there's no policy handbook to follow. However, we're never on our own. You are there for us, with us, in us, working through us. And you often, as we look back, we realize you often have shown yourself strong. Do that, we pray, at this decadent time in this difficult era. Bring Israel back to a time of peace. Release them from the grip of constant attack. Bring back the hostages. Give hope to those who are feeling hopeless. Give relief to those who have lost their way. Give comfort to those who have lost loved ones. And remind us that you are still enthroned as our God. Be pleased with our gifts as we give them today. Watch over these monies as they are handled with integrity and spent with wisdom. Use these offerings to touch lives of those who are in great need. And looking back, may we realize how great you worked, even in a time when it seemed most was lost. Continue to remind us that you show yourself strong, even when you are silent, even when you are invisible, you are there. We commit the offering and this prayer to you in the name of Christ, our Master. Everyone said, amen. Please be seated. Suffering is a required course in God's curriculum for His children. There's no way we can live a life for Christ and not have a time of suffering in our lives. The martyr Dietrich Bonhoeffer called suffering the badge of the true Christian. He wrote that while he was in the Flossenbürg cell, awaiting hanging by the Nazis, which took place on the 9th of April, 1945. He could have been extradited to America and not suffered and not been killed. He had an out, but he chose to stay and suffer with the people of resistance working against the godless Nazis in all of their brutality. Even though he knew the hangman's noose would soon be for him, he pressed on. He later wrote, "The disciple is not above his master. Discipleship means allegiance to the suffering Christ. And it is therefore not at all surprising that Christians should be called to suffer." Do your children know that? Do you remember that? Or do you feel somehow mistreated? Picked on when you face opposition? When you're punched? And you wind up on your back? You know, that's not all bad. When that happens, you're finally looking in the right direction. We're all looking up into the face of the one who suffered and died for us. Furthermore, he's the one who taught his disciples, and I quote from John 15, 18 and 19, listen to this. "If the world hates you, remember that it hated me first." The world would love you as one of its own if you belong to it, but you are no longer a part of the world. I chose you to come out of the world, so it hates you. Easy to forget that. Easy to think that somehow we didn't handle something right, so people have turned against us. On the contrary, you may have been more right than ever in your life. And those who hate Christ hate you, therefore they hate where you stand. I experienced it when I was an apprentice in the machine shop for 4.5 years. I experienced it for years when I was in the Marine Corps barracks. I wasn't a martyr, I wasn't anywhere near that. But I found opposition from those who hated the Christ I loved, because I wasn't willing to love the world they loved. It's important that we rear our children to understand this. Now, obviously, life is not all prejudice and hatred, but some of it includes that. And that can easily lead to disillusionment, depression, confusion, perhaps that as much as anything is the reason God has given us the book of Acts. This wonderful 28 chapter book of the Acts of the Apostles. That's the full name. The early apostles, most of whom died martyrs. The writer to the Hebrews says, "What more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah and David also and the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms and wrought righteousness, and stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, and turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead raised to life. Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. Some were sawn in two. They lived as people without homes, in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented. They were people of whom the world was not worthy." Do you hear that? People of whom the world was not worthy. Destitute, afflicted, tormented, tortured, martyred. They did good, but they lived their lives before those who saw good as evil, and evil as good, like we live in such times, where it's all twisted. And I return to the subject of your children and mine. Do they understand that the world is twisted in its thinking? Do they understand that the majority is rarely right? And that if you live your life hoping to be accepted by the majority, you'll often be wrong. The apostles didn't live like that. So Peter and John, on their way to the temple, pass by the gate, and they see a man with his hands out. And they said, "Silver and gold we have none, but what we do have we'll give to you in the name of and power of Jesus Christ. Stand up and walk." And he stood up and walked. He stood up and walked. Never had in his life. The problem was the miracle took place where the thugs carried out their business. People like Annas and Caiaphas and Alexander, people who had sat around and contrived and connived and conspired so that they would find a way to nail the only perfect person who has ever lived to a cross. And they got wind of this miracle that took place. The miracle didn't bother, it did bother them, but not as much as the reason they claimed the miracle. That's why they confronted Peter and John, asking, "By whose name and by what power have you done this? Who gave you the authority to do this?" Without flinching, without hesitation, Peter and John said, it was through the power of the Lord Jesus Christ, it was in the name of Christ, this man was healed. They didn't stop there. But the men had heard enough for the night. It was getting late. They couldn't put them on trial. So they arrested them and put them behind bars. Stop. Stop. Ever been put behind bars because of your faith? Well, neither have I. But they often were. I don't know if you've stopped to think about the reality of that, but they left their children and family at home. They didn't come home that night. They didn't know if they'd ever come home. These were killers that locked them up. These were thugs. These were crucifying, hateful, revengeful people who especially despised the name of Jesus. So the next day they faced the council. Who's that? Well, in the Jewish day, back in the first century, the Supreme Court was known as the Sanhedrin, 70 men, mainly Sadducees, who not only did not believe in a resurrection, they did not believe in miracles. They weren't ready to hear about either. And Peter and John are brought before them. Stop again. Bonhoeffer was brought before the Gestapo. An inquisition followed more than once. Ever been in an inquisition? Neither have I. So do your best to imagine. Hateful, prejudiced people who could not be fair if they tried are sitting as your judge, and they're listening to you talk about what's actually happened, and the foundation of all of it is your faith. That's why you're in front of them. That's why you're on trial. I've been thinking about this for a couple of weeks. Every time I close my Bible and turn the lights down in my study and just sit at my desk, I feel a little frightened for them. But they weren't. They weren't. They didn't hesitate. By what authority, in whose power or name did you do this thing? It was in the name of Jesus Christ, and Peter didn't stop there, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. In other words, who is alive among us and healing people, just like this beggar. The inquisitors are stunned. Read it for yourself. Let your mind go free. Get away from the tradition of just reading words and going on to chapter 5. Pause and let it sink in. They're stunned. How could this be? We nailed that man to a cross. He breathed his last. He was taken down as a cadaver. He was laid in a grave. Nonsense about the resurrection never happened. May have stolen his body. Somebody may have taken it. He's not raised. But there's no way they can explain away the beggar on both feet, healthy and whole, Something else that stunned them, again, when you read it, you'll see why Peter never flinched. These men spoke with invincible courage. They didn't mumble. They didn't apologize. On the contrary, they, if not pointed fingers, they looked directly into the faces of killers, and they said to those individuals, the one you crucified, God raised, the one God raised, heal this man. He is the one we follow. He is the basis of our faith. He is why our numbers are now what they are, 10,000 or whatever, and we have just begun. And the killers looked at those they were accusing, and they realized two things. First, these are not astute theologians. They are not men with academic letters after their names. They have not studied in the better schools. They've not studied in any theology school. They've not sat at the feet of Gamaliel. They are, well, the King James puts it well, ignorant and unlearned men. They weren't even mentored by one of the chief priests of the temple. So how do they get this kind of invincible courage to talk to us like that, knowing that we have the power of life or death over them? Get this. They took knowledge of them. They have been with Jesus. They're Jesus men. Why did they say that? Because they sounded just like Jesus. He spoke with that kind of invincible courage. He stared them down. He faced them with unflinching confidence. You know what I thought? I even put it in my notes. When they thought, they are just like Jesus. They finally got something right. They got that right. We'd use the words, Jesus is rubbed off on them. Whoa. And I'm sure they thought, what do we do now? Having put Jesus on a cross, nailed him there, watched him die, seen him buried, and now there are 10,000 followers, and they're growing. For us to mess with these two leaders, we're going to have people all over us. There's going to be an uprising like we've never known before. So then began the threats. You know why they really threatened them? Because of what Peter says in verse 12. If you've got your Bible available, verse 12 of chapter 4. Peter looks at those thugs and he says to them, there is salvation in no one else. God has given no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. Now, It's sort of easy these days to deny that. Liberals do all the time. They find ways around it, do all kinds of semantic footwork, explain away those words, much too specific. Specific bothers you? When you want to make a flight from here to St. Louis and you get a hold of an airline, they will tell you you'll need to go to gate 9, take flight 184, which leaves at 9:37 tomorrow morning. If you get on the plane, you'll be in seat 37B, and at this time you'll take off, hopefully, and at that time you'll arrive. And you never think there's anything wrong with that. In fact, you're like that. You know exactly the gate, exactly the flight, exactly the time, exactly the plane, exactly the seat, and you go, great. You get your ticket and you're on. I've never heard anyone go, you know, I don't like things that specific. How many gates are there? Well, there are 27. Can I just take my choice? Sure. You won't wind up where you want to go, but you could take any one of them, and it'll be a different flight, and who knows where you'll wind up. See how silly it is? Salvation is important as it is for eternity, and people are saying it's too specific. It better be specific, or I don't know where I'm going to wind up. I don't know for sure that I'll go to where Jesus is if I don't follow his instructions. Where he said, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. Didn't stop there. No one comes to the Father except through me. Merrill Tinney, for years, the one who was the leader, the dean of the graduate school at Wheaton College, wrote this: without the way, there is no going. Without the truth, there is no knowing. Without the life, there is no living. Do you know Jesus? Do you know Jesus? Since there's no other name under heaven by which you must be saved, do you know Jesus? If you don't, you're not saved. If you die, you're in hell. I didn't write it. I only quote it. Don't get fancy and funny about this. This is specific on purpose. And believe me, if the thugs at the temple couldn't figure it out and work out another plan, you can't either. You go God's way or you don't go his way. That's not your destination. And I shudder to think of where you will wind up. And when you get through joking about it with all your buddies, you'll discover too late there's nothing funny about hell. Nothing. So they speak that honestly before these men. The men are at a loss to know what to say. So they threatened them, don't speak again of his name, which was wasted breath, because as soon as Peter and John got back, They were on their way on another mission just like this one. Why am I bringing a message like this? Because of the times in which we live. Very liberal times. Very iffy. Lots of opposition. Lots of voices. All kinds of so-called authorities saying, much too conservative, that's much too narrow. It's not Jesus only. Oh, wait. Isn't that what Peter? Yeah, it's exactly what Peter said. Neither is there salvation in any other. I'm being overbearing here because it's easy to go past this too quickly because you hear so much from the opposition since it is always in the majority. Except at a gathering like this. Suffering may be the required course in God's curriculum, but the one who teaches the course is our strength and our shield. He never left these men behind bars overnight, right there with him. Showing himself strong, encouraging them, telling them, don't give up, don't be afraid. I am with you always. I will be with you to the end. So when they got out from behind bars and they had the chance to speak to those thugs, they didn't wobble for a moment. They started right where they had left off at sundown. Peter Cartwright was a stout-hearted, circuit-riding Methodist preacher of yesteryear. He rode horseback from Tennessee to Illinois because of his hatred for slavery, and he wanted to get to a place where he didn't have to deal with it so often. Wound up in Illinois. There he had a church. There he preached the truth without wavering. Peter Cartwright was known for his strong message. Uncompromising in the truth, unbending regardless of his audience. One Sunday morning early, his deacons got a hold of him and said, you need to know that President Andrew Jackson is visiting our church today. We want to warn you, it would be good if you did not offend the chief executive. So be careful with what you say. Cartwright listened without saying a word. And then when he got to the pulpit, he began, I've been requested to be guarded in my remarks since President Andrew Jackson is here today. So I want to say to everyone, Andrew Jackson will go to hell if he does not repent. Well, I would imagine the deacons didn't know whether to spit or wind their watch about that time. Cartwright never flinched, preached his whole message. Afterwards, everyone wondered what the president thought. Sure enough, right down front, he stood toe-to-toe with Cartwright, and this is what he said. Sir, if I had a regiment of men like you, I could whip the world. Christ needs men and women like that. Now hold on. Before you go out and yell the message of Christ to every waitress you meet at the restaurant, or everyone who may park your car in front of the restaurant, or every neighbor in your neighborhood. Wait a minute. Remember where Cartwright was. He was in his church. It was his sermon to preach. So in that sense, it was absolutely appropriate he say what he should say. He believed God would have him say it. God bless Peter Cartwright for saying it. There's a time and a place to say it, but for God's sake, say it when it's the right time and the right place. Otherwise, you welch on the message and you show yourself a coward. Do not hesitate to stand up for the truth. Believe me, the opposition doesn't hesitate to stand up for its lies. We live in a day when compromise has become a way of life, and where only the Christian is called a fanatic. I hear fanatics in our government every day I watch the news, and I get sick of them. Where are those who speak openly and freely in the right way at the right time regarding their faith in the Savior? Every once in a while, I hear them and I think, God bless you for speaking the truth. Now, again, some of you will hear this and take it the wrong way. So let me say, your opening line ought not always be, you're going to go to hell if you don't believe in Jesus, okay? Cartwright, it's appropriate. There may be a time when it would be appropriate. As I would say to you who are here in this room, if you do not know Christ and if you die in that condition, hell is your destiny. I say that with a broken heart, and I say that nevertheless without apology. There is salvation in no other except the name of Jesus. Trust in Jesus. If you want to get at the right destination, you get at the right gate, you get on the right plane, you sit in the right seat, and you wind up at the right destination. If you want to wind up in heaven and the glories of heaven, you must go God's way through Christ alone, by faith alone, because of his grace alone. Now let me say to all of us, I do not know when we must be called into account. Maybe in my lifetime, and maybe long after I'm gone, but I believe it's nearer than ever. I believe the opposition is on the march. We are clearly in the last days. I don't say that to frighten anyone. Read your Bible, you'll see it. But I'm not setting dates. It may be years before Jesus returns, but we live as though he comes this afternoon. We prepare for him as though it is going to happen in the next hour, because every one of us will die. And we will meet him face to face. And our only ticket to the right destiny is him, Christ Jesus. If you've never met him as your Savior, this is your moment. The great news is heaven awaits you. Trust in Jesus. Come today. Bow with me, will you? Never been a time in your life when you trusted in Christ? Open your heart right now. Tell him you've walked away from him long enough. You've gone your own way long enough. You now want to know that he will be your Savior. So you trust him and him alone as your one and only Lord. Trust him now. Put it off no longer. Thank you, Father, for the truth. Thank you for men like Peter and John who were unintimidated when they stood before the thugs and were willing to tell these evil men the truth, regardless of what the consequences may have been. Give us that kind of courage. Forgive us for welching when it's our moment to speak. Open our lips to speak openly of Christ at the right time, in the right way, for the right reason. I pray in his name, the name of Jesus. Everyone said,
amen. Amen.